Spiritual Living, Capistrano Valley. I'm Heather Clark, and yes, I'm still sheltering in place, although there are six of us here today providing this service for you. We begin by lighting the flames of faith, which is a call to service. We perform this ceremony to promote the universal consciousness of life, which acknowledges that all peoples and all faiths, all sentient beings, come from the one great universal presence, which we call spirit. Fundamental to this truth is the unifying nature of all religious thought and experience, which we honor here today. We light the candle for the Tao, honoring the universal path of harmony and equilibrium, the natural way. We light the candle for the shamanic traditions, honoring the beliefs and practices of all indigenous peoples, the way of primal spirituality. We light the candle for Hinduism, honoring the path of knowledge, action, and devotion. We light the candle for Judaism, honoring the ethical path of living by sacred law. We light the candle for all forms of Buddhism, honoring the Four Noble Truths and the path of compassion. We light the candle for all forms of Christianity, honoring the Christ consciousness as the path of love. We light the candle for all forms of Islam, honoring the path of compliance with the will of God as the highest calling. We light the candle for the universalistic religion of Baha'i, honoring the path of unity and peace. We light the candle for all forms of new thought, honoring the metaphysical path of mental healing through the practice of universal spiritual principles. And as Reverend Judy lights the last candle, let it represent the path that brought you here this morning. And now she is going to set us up with an opening prayer.
Good morning. Let us go within so that we will never be without, knowing the truth. And the truth is, there is only one divine purpose, one awesome magnificence, one divine intelligence, one unconditional love, one life, one joy, and one presence. And this one, which is all-encompassing, all-loving, all-knowing, lives and moves and expresses as each one of us. For we truly are the sacred activity of this beloved energy. We are the life, we are the joy, we are the compassion, we are the love. And this happens through our thoughts, our actions, our prayers, and our being. And so this morning I affirm and I decree that all is well, and that each one of us is right where we need to be, right at this moment of now. And we recognize that we are all here in our life for a purpose. It is our life's purpose, and that purpose is to be love, to be joy, to be compassion. I know that everyone that hears my voice feels that connection with all of life, with all beings, with all intelligence. And so it is with a grateful heart that we listen this morning to Dr. Heather's message with our spiritual ears, listening with wisdom, listening to the wisdom, listening to the love, listening to this blessed message. And so I place my words into divine mind, where they truly have already been created as they were spoken. And so my heart is full of love and gratitude and thanksgiving for this time together, for the connection that we have forever, and for this beautiful center that is here for us. And so I release, I let go, and I know that it is so, as we say together, and so it is.
Thank you, Reverend Judy. We're going to begin our service with meditation, and Ellendale created a song, a chant, several years ago. It's one of my favorites. We're going to start with that chant. You have the lyrics somewhere. They're on the website. They might even be right there where you're watching. And join in, please. And as we continue to deepen through the lyrics, I will guide you in a meditation at the end. Essential part of the community. You don't have to do anything. There's nothing to struggle with. There is simply a willingness to allow that divine presence to be God in you as you, in the circle of this community, in the circle of God, in the circle of friends. And in the silence, let that awareness expand and grow in you. Thank you. That brings us to the end of our meditation time. Ellen Dale did a standing meditation. Reverend Judy is now going to read the affirmation and the declaration of principles.
Our declaration of principles. I believe in God, the one creative intelligence operating through the universe and throughout my entire being, now and always. I believe this perfect spirit operates upon a law of mind and creates my experience exactly according to my belief. I believe this perfect creative intelligence can be used by me and by every other person to produce health, abundance, and love in mind, body, and total life experience. I use it now, and I rejoice in it, and so it is. And now my personal affirmation that I've had for 20 years. I am open and receptive to the abundance that is mine to have and to share. So repeat it after me. I am open and receptive to the abundance that is mine to have and to share. And so it is.
So it is. Thank you, Reverend Judy. And now Ellen Dale is going to sing a beautiful song.
We are called to be everything. peace, called to be joy, called to be free. Called to be peace, called to be joy, called to be love, called to be.
Thunderous applause. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Wow, that sets up my message so perfectly. This whole month is listen to your heart, and today's message is your great work of life, your great work in life, your great work. It's your purpose, it's your dharma, it's the what is it that you could do all night long and never get tired, never notice that the time has passed. What is it that will just make your heart sing? It's your heart song. It is what you're called to be. And I suspect that there is a deeper call in all of us than even the wonderful things that we're doing right now. We are surrounded, I'm in a group of musicians here that are extraordinary musicians. Jimmy Band is not getting to be a musician right now, he's getting to be a cameraman, but he's getting to be able to support his wife, Diane King Band, who's providing the structure and the piano music today, and Alan Dale, whose music is so exceptional, exquisite, and they're creations are so exquisite. And Reverend Judy even, just thinking about that, she helped support herself as a younger woman by playing guitar and singing in a nightclub. And in my old days, I was a choir director and played piano for the First Church of Religious Science in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. Now, that all leads to the perfect segue to the calling, to the deep calling. In 1985, before I was pianist for that center, I had an awakening. I had a calling. I knew that my life from that moment on was dedicated to God. And I also knew that my calling was to spread the good news, to spread the word, to proselytize, evangelize, and let other people know God is real, God is good, and God is for us, loves us. It's been such an interesting journey, and for each of us, the notes on this message were put together by the team of ministers that look after ministers, the ministerial team, and wonderful, wonderful work that they do. One of the things that they said is there's a spark in each one of us. And that is truly so. Ernest said that in, I think, this thing called You. There's a spark, a divine spark that cannot be extinguished, that has always been there. And when you discover God in you, in the universe, it is that igniting of that spark that's always been there. It's your birthright. You were born with it. You will still have it when you make your transition to the next life. It is yours eternally. But the thing about answering the call and saying yes, that means answering to allow yourself to be a vessel for the goodness, the greatness, the power of God. To get your bloated nothingness out of the way of the divine circuits, as Emerson says, to truly let yourself be that exquisite presence that is God. And every one of us has a deep calling that utilizes all of our talents and skills and interests, that is something that not only makes our hearts sing, but we can usually end up doing it fairly easily. In these notes, they refer to Gay Hendricks' book, The Big Leap. So I was reading it yesterday. And Gay Hendricks is a man I've known about for years, mostly through Mary Morrissey. He's written dozens of books. He and his wife, Kathleen, have written books together. And his own life, he said, he was working really well. Things were good, but they weren't excellent. He knew there was more. But what he noticed was every time things would be going really well, something would happen. It was almost like a cosmic call saying, you've gone too far, things are too good. Something would happen that would cause him to shine his light a little less brightly. And he realized that that was a pretty common thing for people. We used to call it the comfort zone. And in the old days, in my beginning studies, when I was first studying this, that comfort zone, we would look at the people who were wonderful salespeople. And I don't know if this is really true, but I heard back in the 80s that it was true of IBM, that they would take their top salespeople, the ones that were just making huge leaps and gains and had so many clients and customers, and they would put them in an area where the salesperson wasn't doing so well. And the strangest thing happened. That terrible area that no one wanted would all of a sudden become the sweet spot. It wasn't about the area. It was about the enthusiasm, the presence, the skills of the leader. And so instead of firing people, which evidently they were also, they encouraged, how do you continue to go through that glass ceiling to get to that place of excellence? In his book, he says, it's as if we have four expressions. Our first expression is incompetence. I can testify that is true. Our first expression is incompetence. I would practice when I was the choir leader, I would rehearse in my home 60 hours. And I was teaching school full time, so every minute I was to be able to do what Diane, Jimmy, so many do, seemingly so easily without any errors. Then I would get to Sunday and there'd be an error, and all those 60 hours would feel like, oh, what have I been doing? It was a passion. I loved it. I volunteered for it, and I might have told you this before. I volunteered because the first Sunday that I showed up at this little center, they had an accordion player, and he wasn't very good. Now, if it had been a really good accordion player, I would probably never have volunteered. But at the end of the service, the minister said, if any of you play an instrument, and they had an old piano there in that bar where we were meeting on Sunday morning, if anyone plays an instrument, please let me know. You only have to play two songs. And I went home and went, I can do that. So I called her up and said, I'd be willing to try doing it next Sunday. Well, that next Sunday lasted for 7 years. Sunday after Sunday, and I grew better. I might have even grown past incompetence to competence. I never got to excellence. It was never, even though I loved it, I loved music, I could sit and listen to other people, I could sit and sing for hours. It was not my calling, and I knew it. When I moved from Edmonton to Calgary, I actually joined the choir that they had there, which was kind of fun. I got to do some things. It was a very different thing, not being the one at the piano. And I was filled with all sorts of self-doubt. I remember asking the choir director, please audition me, because I don't know if I'm on pitch or not. I can't tell. I'm so used to my voice, and I'm far away from the piano. I'm not playing, I'm listening. I might have gotten to competence. Didn't get to excellence. But that wasn't my real calling. My real calling was to be someone that helped people awaken to their own magnificence. Someone who led a group of people and created community even when there's a pandemic and we're not encouraged or allowed to be together. Someone who cares very deeply for each person in this community. And over the years, it got a little better, a little better, a little better, so that there was an area of excellence for some things. I never have to think about prayer again, ever, because it is just a natural download. Spirit's just doing it, and that's, although it's through my channel, it's not through someone else's frequency, it's through mine. So what Gay said, you know, all of us sabotage that, the leap from excellence to genius. And let's face it, if God's in charge, it's genius. That's the very ultimate. When God is doing it through us, that's our genius. That's when, I spoke about Beethoven last week, that's when the music is in our heads, it's already there. That's when the words are already in our hearts. The actions are already in our hands and minds, that calling. But what he did, he led people to understand that sabotage was always something within them, unconscious, unknowingly, to stay in that comfort zone. And some of the things that he noticed are our old friends. We speak of them often. Things like blame. Things like blame. Things like anger. Things like gossip. Things that couldn't possibly be true of God. Just think about any quality that you think of. Fear. God could not be afraid and still be the creator, the source. Could not. It's impossible. God could not be a gossip, because that would mean that there'd be a place where God was separated from God. God could not blame or in any way separate itself. My very favorite passage from the Science of Mind textbook, many of you know it, I quote it often, or I paraphrase it often. It's on page 298 and finishes up on 299. And it says this: For selfish reasons alone, you cannot afford to blame, judge, or in any way suggest anything about any other person other than love. For the God of love cannot hear the prayer of the one who fails to love. The God of love cannot hear the prayer of the one who fails to love. So your area of excellence rises up to genius when you allow that presence within you to guide you, when you open yourself to good and good only, when you stand so solidly in the truth of your being that there's nothing else that could ever touch you. And it is interesting that I would be saying something like this in these times, but it's true now, just as it always has been and always will be. I believe that we've been given, cosmically, a gift. And that gift is to have time, if we use it, if we choose to use it. I actually like spending my time playing words with friends, but the deeper call is to look at where did I diminish someone else today? Where did I judge someone else? So here's a hint. If you have your television on at all, you're going to be judging. There's going to be some judgment. There's going to be some opinion. And Raymond Charles Barker, one of my favorite old-timers of science and mind, used to read the New York Times. He lived in New York. He'd read it from cover to cover. And then he'd close it and go, not a word of truth in it. And what he was saying is, he read it to keep himself informed, but he wasn't believing any aspect of it as truth. None of it was God. It was all God, and yet it was none of it was the truth of God. The truth of God that truly sets us free. So ask yourself, are you comfortable in your life right now? There used to be a book, The Comfortable Pew, that's not making waves, not speaking up. Are you comfortable? Are you living a life of excellence? And I know most of you are. I know you. And you are really good at what you do. We have, in this community, we have actors and singers and dancers. We have accountants. We have doctors. We have legal people. We have all sorts of people. And the question is, is there more good that you could let into your life? One of my great friends is a physician, and she was sharing with me that her life wasn't in perfect order. I think, I would say, based on Hendrick's work, her life is excellent. It's excellent. She's at the top of her game. But her heart isn't happy. She does not have everything that she wants. And yet from the outside, people looking at her, from the outside looking in, would say, wow, what a great life. We never know someone else. So we never know someone else's life. One of the things that Hendrick says in his book is, most of us would never say we love to play the victim. None of us would say that. And yet, listen to this scenario. She says, you're making me so miserable. Everything you do makes me miserable. Can't you just stop it? You see how miserable I am? And he says, you're absolutely right. It's all my responsibility. I have made you miserable. I'm the perpetrator and you're the victim. That does not happen. That does not happen. What usually happens in an argument would be, you make my life so miserable. Person two would say, I make your life miserable? You make my life miserable. And then it would be a challenge to see who could out-victim each other. Out-victim each other. I'm even more miserable than you are. Oh my gosh, get that Velcro. You know, this one, that Velcro, that one. Get that Velcro. I'm going to claim my queen victim spot. No, we don't want that. We don't want it for each other. We don't want it for ourselves. What God in us wants us to know is that we're powerful beyond measure. And that we're good. And that we're in a circle together. We're all in the circle. Everyone belongs in the circle. There are no beings that do not belong. Everyone belongs in the circle. We're good and only good. So what I know is that we take this idea this week, think about it. Is there a place in your life where excellence is good enough? I know none of you are going to say incompetence is good enough, or even competence is good enough, but is excellence good enough? Is there more good you're longing to see? This is the time we can really tell ourselves the truth. We can tell ourselves the truth because for many of us, we're the only ones there. we can tell ourselves the truth. And then we can see, what is it that I would rather have? And where have I been separating myself from that invisible power that always says, yes, my beloved, that always sees us as whole, complete, perfect beings, spiritual beings, so filled with beauty and grace and good and God. So I invite you in this next week, especially if you're alone, but even if you're not, to take some time, to take some time and ask yourself, where is my level of expression? Is it genius? Is it excellence? Is it competence? Is it incompetence? Tell the truth. And then allow that power to flow through you, to guide you to how, to the next level of expression that is yours and yours alone. And have a wonderful week doing it. I imagine you singing your song, singing out in your garden, singing as you're in your car, telling yourself the truth. Reverend Judy shared with us her powerful affirmation. That's been her affirmation for 20 years. Powerful. And it expands. It's an affirmation that is one of those that you could accept as yours. The thing itself is moving through you right now. It's guiding you to love more, to accept more, to become more. Let yourself evolve. Your life story, the purpose of your life, is to express more God. And you can do that every single moment of every day. I'm here with you, I'm here for you. I'm so glad that this is our center and we're doing this work together. So I release this word, I say thank you God, it's done, it's complete, and so it is. And now I'm going to pray, and Diane's going to underscore. I'm going to pray in the first person. So take the parts that are true for you and allow them to really resonate in your heart, mind, and soul. In this holy moment of right now, I recognize and know that there's a power for good greater than I am. And I can use it. Its whole purpose is to be used. It is the creator. It is the first cause of all creation. It is that which is beating my heart, that which is growing my body, that which is moving through me is joy. That's what's moving through me is beauty, is grace, is wholeness. It is life. It is the gift of life, and this thing itself that is life in me is good and very good and only good. What I know is I am the wholeness of God. That wholeness is divine life. It fills every cell, every tissue, every function, every fiber of my body, of my temple, of my mind. It fills me with grace, with joy, with love. It fills me with well-being. It fills me with God's presence. I know that I am loved because God is love. And so I'm loving and lovable, and that's just my nature. I am so grateful for all the ways love shows up in my life. I'm grateful for this moment of loving. I'm grateful for the love. I'm grateful for the wholeness. I know that I am the prosperity, the abundance of that divine life. And I know that that abundance is ever increasing, increases within, and then the experience increases. Every particle of my life is filled with God's grace, God's good, God's increase. I know that I am enough. And so any ideas of incompetence are now simply released. The past is the past. And in this present moment, I am open and willing to make that quantum leap from excellence to genius, to letting the genius of God speak through me, be me, be my love, be my grace, be my ministry. I speak this word for each one, knowing that each one is called to a greater expression than he or she is doing right now, greater expression, more genius, if you like. And what I know is that genius, that inner genius, is totally without any kind of self-criticism or judgment. It is simply beingness. So in the one, in the circle, I do belong. I am strong because I am filled with God's love and God's grace. And with my heart filled with gratitude, knowing that every aspect of my life, including my creativity, has been blessed by this idea. The genius is out of the bottle, and so it is. And now Elle and Dale are going to set us up for our offertory time. It's time for us to give back. It's time for us to circulate our good. So that circulation looks like giving. It looks like giving of our love, giving of our money, giving of our substance. And if you've been blessed by the Center for Spiritual Living, Capistrano Valley, I invite you to give. You can send your checks to the Center, 1201 Puerta del Sol, San Clemente, 92673. Or you can go to our website and press the donate button. We are still waiting to hear about our donate button on Facebook Live, but it is in process, so that will be available. And what I know is we take that money, we take that love, we bless it. We know that nothing grows if it stagnates. So we circulate our time, we circulate our love, we circulate our energy, we circulate our money. And I'm so very grateful for knowing what I know. I'm grateful for the principle of life that is forever flowing through each one of us. So grateful for everyone who is watching, everyone who is letting their inner genius out, everyone who is giving whatever it is they're giving. With my heart overflowing with gratitude, I simply say, thank you, God. This is enough. And so it is. And then listen to this wonderful song that Ellen Dale has chosen.
This moment, in this place, I remember who I am, letting fear and worry fall away from me. I open my eyes and see there is only sets us free.
here, and thank you, Michael Gott, who's the first person I heard that song from. I just love it. It's so beautiful and so amazing. We've come to the end of our service, so I just want to remind you, 11:45, the prayer rooms are open. Go in and get a prayer from one of these wonderful practitioners. And at 1 o'clock, our Conscious Connections will be as usual, and invite everybody to come to that Zoom meeting. And I think it's time for closing with the peace song. Remember, Judy wanted to come up here. Social distance, of course. With each one of us, the inner genius is out of the bottle, and so it is.